Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Paul Erickson. I am a program director for Humanities, Arts, and Culture at the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in Cambridge, Massachusetts. I'd like to welcome all of you today, and also want to note that many people are logging in from different time zones. So for those of you on the West Coast, thank you for getting up early to listen today. For those of you who are new to the Academy, I want to briefly describe who we are and what we do. The Academy was founded in 1780 while the Revolutionary War was still going on by John Adams, John Hancock, James Bowdoin, and a group of about 60 other leaders in Massachusetts who thought that the country they were working to build would need institutions that would bring together knowledge and skill from all fields and put them to service of the new nation. Today, the Academy does two main things. First, we function as an honorary society, electing members from all disciplines of scholarship, as well as business, law, journalism, public affairs, and the creative arts. We currently have over 5,000 members in the United States, along with over 500 international honorary members around the world. Second, the Academy operates as an independent, nonpartisan research center that conducts research projects in five main subject areas. These projects are designed to have an impact on government policy, educational practice, and philanthropy, as well as to reshape the terms of conversation around issues of importance to American society. The Commission on the Arts is a multi-year initiative that the Academy launched in 2018 with the support of several foundation partners as well as individual donors. It is the first major research project the Academy has undertaken that focuses specifically on the arts. Our commission co-chairs, actor and author John Lithgow, former poet laureate of the United States, Natasha Trethewey, and president of the Kennedy Center, Deborah Rutter, have assembled a group of over 40 artists, arts leaders, educators, and scholars from around the country to reframe the national conversation about the role of the arts in a diverse 21st century democracy. What do the arts do in American society today? And perhaps more importantly, what can the arts do that other forms of communication cannot? These and other questions are central to the discussion that the Commission will be having over the next 2 years. As our work proceeds, we hope to highlight particularly exciting programs that illustrate new approaches to thinking about the arts, new combinations of disciplinary perspectives, and new insights into what the arts can do in society as well as in individual lives. Today's webinar is the first in what we hope will be a series of these informational presentations, and we could not have wished for a better topic for our first session than today's discussion of music and the mind. Sound Health is a groundbreaking interdisciplinary collaborative project exploring connections between health, wellness, and music. Bringing together neuroscientists, music therapists, and supporters of both biomedical research and the arts to discuss the current landscape of research on the interaction of music and the brain, Sound Health is a partnership between the Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts and the National Institutes of Health in association with the National Endowment for the Arts, along with numerous partners in the science and arts fields, such as the National Symphony Orchestra, the National Organization for the Arts and Health, and the American Music Therapy Association. We are delighted to have a set of distinguished presenters today who will talk about their work with Sound Health and provide some insights into what the project can tell us. In order of presentation, they are Renée Fleming, a world-renowned soprano, a winner of 4 Grammy Awards, a recipient of the National Medal of Arts, and artistic advisor to the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts. She will be followed by Dr. Frances Collins, director of the National Institutes of Health, the world's largest supporter of biomedical research. He is also a member of the Academy's Commission on the Arts. In honor of his leadership of the International Human Genome Project, he has been awarded both the Presidential Medal of Freedom and the National Medal of Science. Next will be Commission Co-Chair Deborah Rutter, president of the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts, which is the world's busiest performing arts center. Deborah is deeply involved in reimagining ways of presenting the arts in the 21st century through interdisciplinary programming. Our final speaker is Sunil Iyengar, Director of the Office of Research and Analysis at the National Endowment for the Arts and the Chair of the Federal Interagency Task Force on the Arts and Human Development. And we would ask all of our presenters to keep their phones on mute until it is their turn to present. We hope that you will enjoy today's informative webinar with lots of pictures, video, and data graphics about a project that is a leading example of interdisciplinary collaboration. Participants are invited to submit questions through the webinar interface. Due to time constraints, we will only be able to respond to select questions. Now I will turn things over to Renée Fleming.
Thank you, Paul. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank the American Academy of Arts and Sciences for scientists for hosting today's webinar on sound health. So some of you might be wondering how a singer got on this call. As a longtime consultant to Lyric Opera of Chicago and more recently the Kennedy Center, I've just spent a lot of time thinking about the place of music in our culture. Who listens, who participates, and why, along with the purpose of music in the arts and society today. For a lot of my career as a singer, I suffered with somatic pain as a hedge against performance pressure, which is really stage fright. And this piqued my interest in the mind-body connection. So while following this interest over the years to neuroscience and psychology, I suddenly noticed that scientific researchers were beginning to study music. And I really couldn't imagine why. But then I had the good fortune to meet Dr. Francis Collins. It was at a dinner party, and fellow guests included Supreme Court Justices Scalia, Kennedy, and Ginsburg, who had just that day decided for marriage equality. Francis brought along his guitar, as all directors of major institutions and world leaders do, and I'll let Justice Ginsburg tell the story.
Justice Kennedy wrote the opinion for the court. I joined him. Justice Scalia dissented vigorously. That's an understatement. And yet we were all together that evening at this wonderful dinner that Catherine and Wayne Reynolds had. The head of NIH took out his guitar. Renée Fleming began to sing with him, and everybody joined in, all singing rather raucously, "The times they are changing."
So Francis suggested we might even tour with the Supremes. So I asked Francis if he'd be interested in collaborating with the Kennedy Center at this intersection of research and music. President Deborah Rutter agreed, and along with the National Endowment for the Arts, Sound Health, Music in the Mind was launched. So what we're attempting to bring our audience includes the basic science and research, evolution, childhood development, and the therapeutic value of music. Deborah will speak more about our two major convenings and the ongoing work at the Kennedy Center. So I personally find this work illuminating, and it makes sense to me to use the performing arts as a platform for science. It brings a lifelong learning opportunity to our audiences, and who doesn't love that, allowing us to understand what's going on in the brain when we're listening to or actively playing music, why music makes us cry, rouses memory, and much more. Inspired by Music in the Mind, I created a traveling presentation to accompany my concert tours. It allows performing arts organizations to connect with local researchers, hospitals, therapists, and universities. Each event is unique, with invited local co-presenters able to highlight their own work for the public. I've presented in around 25 cities so far throughout North America, with Europe and Asia coming up this season. Large community service institutions, which both performing arts and healthcare providers are, benefit from collaboration, putting more of a human face on healthcare and aiding in audience development for the arts, even showing young musicians that there are other avenues for their talents than the concert stage. So I'd like to share with you some of what I've learned. Much of the research is fueled by new technology, especially in terms of our understanding of the brain, EEG and fMRI. Audiences are most interested in how music impacts on childhood development, Alzheimer's and dementia, autism, aging, and our own veterans' welfare. So starting with evolution and basic research, music helps us to bond, to connect. It strengthens community. And we know this from weddings to political rallies. It incites and inspires both love and war. Every human civilization in history has had music. It varies a lot from culture to culture. And many, including Darwin, believe that music even predated language. This is how I've come to understand the continued power of music on the brain. We simply don't evolve quickly, and we've had the same vocal mechanism for 500,000 years. I kind of love that, imagining a Neanderthal opera. Dr. Ani Patel, currently writing a book on music and evolution, told me that many scientists agree that music has played a role in evolution, but whether it's primarily a biological trait like speech or a cultural invention like writing has divided scientists since Darwin. And new technologies are starting to give us a greater understanding of the brain structures involved in music processing. This is why, for instance, exposure to music and rhythm helps children. Children studying music develop language and reading faster and have better listening comprehension, memory, problem solving, and focus. Music training can also give students from a lower socioeconomic status a developmental leg up. Sunil Iyengar will be speaking more about this in a bit with current NEA research. The idea of music's power to heal isn't new. More than two millennia ago, Plato thought of music as medicine of the soul. With World Wars I and II, musicians helped to bring comfort to veterans living with trauma and injury, and music therapy became an established profession. Now music therapists treat disabilities and conditions including Alzheimer's, autism, PTSD, Parkinson's, brain trauma, stroke, and chronic pain, considering each patient's taste and values. For adolescents, for example, a cancer diagnosis can disconnect them from their friends and rob them of their growing autonomy. Dr. Sherry Lynn Robb in Indiana works with teens and their families to write lyrics and record pop songs that express emotions difficult to share, fostering hope. Music also strengthens the connection between emotion and memory. Music memory is often the last to go in adults with Alzheimer's and dementia, and I've witnessed this myself with a relative. Melodic intonation therapy allows patients with stroke and traumatic brain injury to use singing to regain speech, drawing on neuroplasticity, the brain's remarkable ability to forge new pathways, something I'm glad has been recently discovered to continue throughout our lives. Old dogs, new tricks, indeed. Former Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords benefited from this therapy to regain speech. I've also had the opportunity to connect with a brilliant young man named Forrest and his incredible music therapist, Tom Schweitzer, after a harrowing snowboarding accident and traumatic brain injury. This again helped him to regain speech. Rhythm is also incredibly powerful for patients with movement disorders, such as Parkinson's disease. So what's ahead? There's incredible potential for music with technology, including virtual reality, apps, and personalized medicine. Healthcare is set to undergo a rapid shift with the integration of AI, autonomy, meaning far fewer doctors and nurses. The benefit is access, which is important. But as a society, should we ask ourselves if there's a benefit to maintaining human interaction in healthcare and what that might look like in the future? In our current system of medical treatment, the status quo is generally one-size-fits-all dosage, with often only a single option provided, drugs. But last summer, I had an extraordinary meeting with Dr. Wendy Hsu, the lead medical director for neuroscience at Novartis, who found me after one of my performances of Carousel on Broadway. Through a longitudinal study, Dr. Hsu is researching whether combining music therapy with a new drug for multiple sclerosis could improve the study's performance. Then in March, I visited MIT while performing in Boston, and I had the opportunity to chat with students there who are doing amazing work with gamma wave stimulation. In particular, flashing lights and sounds oscillating at 40 times per second for Alzheimer's and dementia treatment. Their work in mice has shown extraordinary results. The 40 hertz stimulation decreases the amyloid plaque buildup that occurs in the brain. At UCSF, neuroscientist Adam Ghazali is using digital medicine to create video games that adjust and evaluate in real time to properly challenge and reward the user. Ghazali's Neuroscape Lab is the first FDA-cleared non-drug treatment for ADHD, as well as rhythmicity, a game that uses rhythm to improve cognition in older adults. So imagine doctors prescribing personalized gaming in the future. Mickey Hart of the Grateful Dead, who introduced me to Adam, even demonstrated this at our Music in the Mind event at the Kennedy Center this past September. Another researcher I met, Dr. Bin Hu at the University of Calgary, focuses on patients with advanced Parkinson's disease, who are often at risk of falling or freezing when trying to walk. Dr. Hu created a mobile app which uses music as a tool for Parkinson's motor training. And with the app, he hopes to treat the more than 500,000 Parkinson's patients in China. I just read that virtual reality disrupts pain pathways in the brain. Imagine a future of non-invasive medical interventions that make us feel great.
Our next speaker will be Dr. Collins from the NIH.
Well, hello, everybody. Very glad to have a chance to join this conversation and appreciate the wonderful comments from my friend Renée Fleming, who has already laid out, I think, a lot of the excitement that we all are feeling here in terms of what we can now imagine doing to bring together the fields of music and music therapy and neuroscience. So I want to tell you a little bit more about that from my perspective as the director of the National Institutes of Health. And I can speak now on behalf of an entire working group involving multiple scientists here who have banded together to try to see what we could do to explore this area and further enhance the research efforts, which are ballooning now in wonderful ways into new spaces to try to understand the basic science of how music interacts with the brain, all the way to the clinical applications that we believe could be more greatly enhanced by that knowledge. All of this fits together with this brain initiative, which started 4 years ago at NIH, which is a bold effort to try to actually understand how those 86 billion neurons between your ears do what they do. And I do mean bold because each one of those has on the average 1,000 connections. So the complexity of this system is daunting, to put it mildly. Probably the most complicated structure in the known universe is what you're walking around with every day inside your skull. And yet our understanding of it has been growing over the past decades, but it still is missing a lot of the details about how the circuits in the brain do what they do in very complex functions. We can study individual neurons. We can look at pictures of the brain that we can derive by things like MRI scans and PET scans. But the Brain Initiative aims to dig into that space that we haven't had a lot of information about how these circuits do what they do, maybe involving millions of individual neurons connected in a way to carry out a particular function. And one of those functions, of course, is how we interact with the musical world or the sound world around us, and how that has profound influences, not just on the ability to say, oh, I heard that, but how it changes our behavior, affects our emotions, leads us in a pathway towards healing in some instances that we need to understand better. So I'm really delighted to have been able, with Renée as a partner and with Deborah at the Kennedy Center and with Sunil at NEA, to join in this interesting adventure and understanding how sound and health can fit together. This all got started at NIH in a very significant way by a workshop that we held just a little over 2 years ago, bringing together researchers from the U.S., Canada, and Europe who have been working in this space, although I think for the most part, they felt like they were kind of toiling alone, and they were delighted to have NIH invite all these folks to come together and talk about what do we know and what could we know. And you see here some pictures from that gathering of a remarkable group of scientists, performers, music therapists, all trying to figure out what we could learn from each other. In my experience now as the NIH director for 10 years and before that leading the Human Genome Project, sometimes the most exciting and significant events that happen is when you bring people with very different backgrounds together and figure out how they can talk to each other and learn from each other. And that certainly happened at this 2-day workshop. We also were able at that workshop and since then to begin to identify some of the scientific aspects of how music interacts with the brain that are pretty powerful just in terms of what they teach us about how insignificant this must have been down through evolutionary history, as Renée was saying. So for instance, if you look very carefully at how the brain responds to sounds, you can distinguish what happens when you hear a street sound that doesn't have tonality versus a musical sound that does. And this image that you see here, it may look somewhat subtle, but it's quite real. Which part of the auditory cortex responds to music versus speech or other non-tonal sounds? It's quite distinct. Now that's pretty profound. That tells you the brain has a music room And it basically must be the case that that is to some point an advantage to us as a species, or it wouldn't be there. Evolution wouldn't have gone to all the trouble of building a music room unless it was going to have some benefits. And so apparently it does. And again, that does, as Renée pointed out earlier, raise some interesting questions about whether that is something that had biological significance in various ways. Could it have been a social significance primarily? I mean, when we get together and figure out how we're going to do something together, we often sing about it. If we're going to war, sometimes we sing about that too. How many of you have been to a athletic contest? You don't hear people giving a fight speech, they give a fight song. And clearly that has an influence on all of us. So there's a profound significance here of this connection between music and how the brain anatomy appears when you have the sophisticated tools to look at it. And also how the brain responds. This shows you what happens when you look at dopamine in the brain in somebody who is listening to a piece of music that literally gives them chills. I think everybody on this webinar supposedly would imagine a time where you have heard something that would cause you to have chills just from the emotional experience. Maybe it's a familiar piece of music. For me, it might be the Mass in B minor or Mozart's Requiem. And you would feel when you got to that particular moment, the anticipation and then literally a chills. Maybe you'll get tears in your eyes. What's going on there? Well, your brain is releasing a big load of dopamine in your ventral striatum. And you can see the picture of that there, all because of an auditory signal coming to your brain through that pathway and having this big impact on something very profound about who you are and how you feel. And you can't look at that without realizing there ought to be something we could do there also to harness in terms of medical applications and helping people who are struggling with pain or other emotional distress to tap into this kind of response, which can be so powerful. Other things that we've learned is, again, reflecting on the fact that the brain is not wired from the very beginning to have exactly the structure that you end up with. It responds to environmental stimuli, including musical training. This is a diagram that shows you some images, again, of what the differences are between individuals who have had musical training of a fairly intense sort, and it helps if that happens before age 7, because then it has the largest effect. That's when your brain is most plastic. If you basically gave images of a brain to an experienced neuroscientist and said, some of these people had intense training on the violin or the piano before age 6, and others did not, they could tell you which ones. So this whole experience has in fact altered the very anatomy of the brain. There is clear evidence that that spills over into skills that relate to language, which is another reason why many of us feel that the importance of musical training and education ought to be emphasized and not downgraded, which unfortunately has often been happening in terms of public school programs, where music training seems to be considered one of those optional things that can't be afforded anymore. If you really are serious about looking at this data, you have to say that would be very unfortunate, because you're missing out on the opportunities at that time where the brain is most plastic and ready to respond to acquire skills, not just in music, but also in other things that involve sound. And of course, language is a prominent example of that. When it comes to the applications for therapeutics, there are many of them. Because of the time, I'm only going to show you one, but it's one that was mentioned already by Renée. That is that rhythm, just rhythm alone, can turn out to be beneficial in specific instances where individuals are struggling with motor problems. And here I'm speaking specifically of Parkinson's disease. So what I want to show you on the left side of this is a brief video of a person with Parkinson's disease who's simply attempting to walk through those doors, turn around and walk back again, without the benefit of any particular intervention. So you can sort of see what the baseline is that this individual has to work with. And here we go. So little short steps, which is part of Parkinson's. And then notice when he gets and tries to turn around, It really takes a while to get started again. That sort of difficulty initiating movement, a cardinal sign of Parkinson's because of its effect on the brain. So that's what the baseline would be for this person. Now imagine what happens if you simply insert into that a regular metronome beat that provides some kind of a clue for the nervous system to respond to. Same task now being attempted again, but with the audio track. See the difference? Walking very smoothly, getting through the door without having to restart at that point, which he had to do before. All of that indicating just how powerful this kind of auditory input can be. Well, out of that workshop that we held a little more than 2 years ago, came a rather well-cited report. This is in the journal called Neuron, which is one of the highest regarded neuroscience journals in the world, reporting on what it was that was discussed, and not just, well, what we knew about the past, but what we thought were opportunities for the future. And so this article includes research recommendations to accelerate the study of music's effects on the brain and its implications for human health. And we, NIH, wouldn't be sponsoring a workshop or putting forward a paper like this unless we thought there was something interesting to be done and something that we would like to take part in creating as an opportunity for researchers out there. So let me tell you where we have been since then. We've had this wonderful experience of working with the Kennedy Center. Now, in two instances, in June of 2017 and September of 2018, with a remarkable gathering of scientists, music therapists, performers, people like Ben Folds creating music on the spot there, and a variety of other experiences that I was honored to be part of, and which I think brought a lot of people together to begin to appreciate just what a moment this is. They got to see interesting examples of how some of the scientists are using music in therapeutic ways. They got to see what Renee's brain scan looks like when she's singing in an MRI scan and activating various parts of her brain and a whole variety of other things. And I suspect Deborah, when she's going to talk in a few minutes, may say a bit more about our wonderful experiences here at the Kennedy Center. And they got written about a bit too as well. This got some attention, which is, I think, something that a lot of people have resonated with. Wow, this is really a great moment here to think about how science and music can get together. We can bring together the arts and the sciences. This is not a two cultures thing, as C.P. Snow once famously said. Here's an opportunity to build a bridge that's not just a nice idea. It's actually really interesting and really consequential for both music and for science. So finally, I just want to show you the timeline of where we have been and where we're going from NIH's perspective here in terms of this sound health milestone. You can see across this timeline the various points I'll just point to. Again, I'm not going to mention all of them. The workshop I mentioned in January of 17 here, Renee coming to NIH and having the experience of being a research subject to see what happens in the brain when a very expert performer is singing, although it's probably hard to sing with all that racket around you. The performances at the Kennedy Center. Renee and I published something in JAMA, the Journal of the American Medical Association, about sound health, again, getting the word out there. And then we put together this trans-NIH Music and Health Working Group, led by Tom Cheever, Bob Finkelstein, and Emmeline Edwards. And they began to really get their heads around what the research opportunities might be. Those were published in this journal, Neuron. The second Kennedy Center event coming up then in 2018. And then in October of last year, this is where the real research opportunity became a reality. Published funding opportunities, announcements, encouraging people with great ideas to respond to this funding opportunity and send in their ideas for possible research with a grant application due date in January. Scientific review of those applications happening. And now by July, funding of these supported research grants from NIH and NEA on music and health. So we will have roughly from NIH's perspective about $5 million of research that would not otherwise have happened had it not been for this. We have funded research in this space. It's been at fairly modest level. This is sending a big signal to the community that we want to expand that effort. We want to bring disciplines together, particularly excited about the idea of how music therapists and neuroscientists could speak to each other and learn from each other and try to make that whole field of music therapy even more rigorously evidence-based, which is something that could benefit lots of people in lots of different conditions. So it has been a really wonderful ride so far. It's been a delight for me personally to be part of this team. Glad for the chance to be able to tell you about it today as part of this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Francis, and hello, everyone. This is a dream come true to be having a national platform to talk about a subject that is so important for those of us in the performing arts, but also as scientists and music therapists. I am so personally, as well as institutionally proud and excited by this really unique partnership. And it really is a true partnership in that each of us bring what we do best to communicate about something that is important to all of us. So in my case, I continue to say that I feel somewhat insecure speaking about the science, especially following Dr. Collins here, but clearly Renée has gotten this down to a well-practiced presentation because she's pretty fantastic with it. What we do here at the center is do what we do best, which is to provide a platform that can communicate both immediately to our audiences here in within the Kennedy Center, and then to share it broadly through digital means to colleagues and interested individuals and institutions across the country. We do that through performances, we do that through convenings, we do that through existing and ongoing programs as well as the new programs, and Dr. Collins has mentioned that just now. So I'd like to give you a little bit of a video overview of what the project means for us here at the Kennedy Center. So the overview gives you a good sense of the Kennedy Center. We are not just a musical organization. We have dance, theater, all different types of music. And one of the exciting things I think we learned from the work that we've learned from our scientists is that really it's all kinds of music. It's not just one type of music. And I think that's an important piece to know. This slide gives you a little bit of an idea of the existing and ongoing programs. Some of it is new to us. The Kennedy Center has a huge breadth of programming that we offer, as I've mentioned in that way, but also through education programs. But one of the exciting things that we decided to add was around yoga. The inspiration on Second Saturdays was really from Renée, who said, why can't we do something for families on an ongoing basis? And so we currently do them two mornings, two workshops once a month, and it's been so popular that we're increasing it. The National Symphony Orchestra really was the first to start work around the Sound Health Project in coordination with the National Institutes of Health, mostly doing it out of goodwill and interest in and giving back. But now we understand the greater value in coming and performing within the NIH community for patients and caregivers, as well as scientists and doctors. And lastly, on the bottom right, the Daybreaker is something that's really fun here that we do following our yoga class. And now as we look to an expansion of our community here and our physical presence here in DC, we'll be doing a whole lot more of that. I want to tell you a little bit about the concerts themselves and what the Kennedy Center specifically did. Francis alluded to that. We decided, what can we as a performing arts organization do around sharing the news about the scientific findings, and felt like, given who we are and the platform that we can offer, it would be to have a combination of activities, and specifically invite the scientists and the music therapists to tell their story and to demonstrate it through performance. So as Dr. Collins mentioned, we've had two of them. And one was with the National Symphony Orchestra, and Renée, as you can see on the top right, and that's a good example. The orchestra programming is really extensive in this way, and there should be a way in which all orchestras across the country can do this. But when we didn't have an orchestra available for our second one, we knew that we could focus on rhythm and sound and movement. And so, as Renée mentioned, we had Mickey Hart central to that program. As you can see, we had Sanjay Gupta come to that second program as a host, giving a little bit of extra color. I love that in each of these two concerts, Renée and Francis have brought back that moment when they met in the first place with Dr. Collins performing. I'm telling you, being a scientist on the stage with Renée Fleming takes a lot of courage, Francis, and that's pretty impressive. So the next video that I want to show you is a part of the video aspect of what we did within the performance itself, just to give some more science and less soft talk about it. But this is that moment when Renée went and had her MRI. So here we go.
I've noticed research coming out about the fact that music has been discovered to be in a lot of parts of the brain, and therefore it engages so much of us.
It's an exciting time in neuroscience, where we're beginning to understand how the brain interacts with the environment, and music is a really important part of the environment. And we're starting to learn ways in which music can influence all kinds of other aspects of one's brain function, and especially how we could use that information to use music therapeutically in an even more powerful way. This initiative aims to bring together communities that haven't necessarily gotten to know each other that well yet. The neuroscientists and the actual composers, performers, musicians who have the full grasp of the power of music and the variety of different styles.
Renée, thank you so much for coming in to do this experiment with us today. Could I give you a tour of some of the parts of the brain we might see activity in? Mm-hmm. So this is one place we'll look for activity in your scan. It's the part of your brain that we call the motor cortex. It controls everything in your body. When you're singing, you're also speaking. And so we're going to look for activity in some of the parts of your brain that are important for forming speech. This one here is called Broca's area, and there's another one farther back called Wernicke's area. You know, if you have injuries in either one of these parts of the brain, then you can't form normal speech. So this is the auditory cortex. There's a spot near the middle where the information sort of starts, and then as you move outward, it's processing the information more and more. I think we're ready to get you set up in the scanner.
Great.
Ready to go?
Yeah.
All right, let's do it. We're gonna start our first scan.
We're starting to learn ways in which music can influence all kinds of other aspects of one's brain function, and especially how we could use that information to use music therapeutically. What does the brain look like when somebody is speaking? Okay, there's certain parts that are lit up. What does it look like if they're performing music? Other parts lit up, you're using more of your brain. If we could learn from that about how to fully empower people to use that creative talent that we're all born with, but oftentimes gets kind of pushed to the side by daily activities, I think that would be pretty amazing. And maybe this project can help with that.
So So my point in sharing that, because obviously you've heard a good deal of the information already, was to demonstrate how we were able to use this information in the concert setting and to amplify information that we were sharing from the stage and in performance through video. Now, paired with each of these performances was a full day, literally from about 8 until 10 o'clock, 8 a.m. in the morning till 10 o'clock at night, of the equivalent of TED Talks in various parts of the Kennedy Center. We work very closely with NIH and certainly with Renée as well to identify the appropriate individuals who could partner in terms of presenting their findings and using performance in those findings to amplify the message. So we've had a wide variety of individuals, as you can tell, around music education, around music therapy, around building community, and ultimately one of the most fascinating parts was when we talked about creativity and performance and jazz musicians. These were in smaller settings, but very enthusiastically connected to audiences who had an interest in each area. So for instance, the first time out, we had one around childhood development, around aging, around music therapy, and then creativity. So it was a really powerful opportunity for us to bring in national experts in science and pair them with performers to help amplify their message. So in conclusion, I have a video and a couple of slides after that that I have found so compelling and that I have shared broadly here at the center with my board, with members of the Department of Education, to really talk about the power of music for brain development and brain repair. And so this comes directly out of the second of the two performances that we did, and Dr. Charles Lim with a really extraordinary young man, a jazz musician, Matthew Whitaker. So here's the next video.
This is the grand hallway to the scanner.
Right.
I am Matthew Whitaker, and I am a musician. I'm 17 years old, and I'm also visually impaired.
So today we want to see what's happening in Matthew's brain while he's doing a variety of things. One was playing a blues, and one was playing a song that he'll play for the Kennedy Center tonight, and another was listening to music that he liked and maybe listening to something that wasn't as interesting. And lastly, it's having a musical conversation with another musician to see what's happening when two players have a dialogue together, sort of a wordless conversation that's just based on music. The entire time, you're going to be in the scanner room. We're going to be in the control room about maybe 10 feet away from you, but separated by a glass window and a door.
Okay. Is it like a recording studio, my control room?
It's sort of like a recording studio. So the goal is to understand the neural underpinnings for something as complex, wonderful, and mysterious as music. I mean, we have a lot of scientific knowledge about how the world works, but relatively little knowledge about how the brain enables the arts. Art has been around throughout eternity. As long as there's been humans, there have been art. Every culture, every historical epoch, there's always been art. And so what I'm trying to understand is how can we use the arts to sort of unravel this complex neural circuitry that gives rise to new ideas.
Technology, you know, has come really far, you know. I like how it just kind of analyzed, right, musically what I was, you know, thinking of. And I wonder, you know, what the results will be.
In the end, it seems that humans are hardwired to create, and that may be linked to how humans actually survive.
So the next two slides actually come from Dr. Lim's presentation at the concert itself. And this is the visual of the MRI taken from when Matthew was listening, quote, to a boring lecture, somebody just talking to it. And I think it's important to get just a sense of this and see what's lit up or what is not lit up, specifically the auditory visual cortex, et cetera. go to the next slide, which is where he is actually playing music, I find this to be absolutely stunning, which is how his brain has lit up while he is actually making music, including the visual cortex, which is one that is pretty dormant, I would say, for Matthew, but how his brain truly comes alive by playing music. And this is a little bit of the video that he showed us. Look at that brain scan. Pretty striking. And Dr. Collins, if you need to say anything to correct me, please feel free to do so. But I am so in love with these slides, I can't not share them.
I'm right there with you.
thank you. You're so encouraging. So my last slide is just to say, the positive reaction that we have had around this topic, from certainly from scientists who have been so eager to tell their story and to be heard by the general public, and then the general public participating in a whole wide variety, and the inspiration that it has given to families, young people, and people really of all ages to learn more about it and participate. And that last one on the bottom right, just to say, is Mickey Hart in one gigantic drum circle here at the Kennedy Center. It was pretty fun and exciting. I will close with that and hand it off to our colleague at the NEA, Sunil Iyengar.
Thank you very much, Deborah. Hi, everyone. I took the slide of Matthew's brain as a gentle admonition not to give a boring lecture, so I'll try not to do that. hi, everyone. It's an honor to present both alongside and to such distinguished groups today. The National Endowment for the Arts is an independent federal agency. We fund, promote, and strengthen the creative capacity of communities by providing all Americans with diverse opportunities for arts participation. What you may not know is that we also conduct and commission studies about the arts. So today, I'll briefly share some of our ongoing research related to music and its benefits, but I also want to acknowledge the work of my colleague, Ann Meyer Baker, who directs the music and opera divisions at the NEA. On behalf of this agency, she and I are proud partners in supporting the Sound Health Initiative. The Office of Research and Analysis of the National Endowment for the Arts is one essential function to measure the value and impact of the arts for individuals and society. We've produced an evidence-based 5-year agenda that drives our current research investments. As milestones of that work, we typically produce research reports, briefs, and data visualizations for the general public. Crucial to getting the job done, though, is teaming with much larger federal agencies and departments of the government. So as you heard from Dr. Collins, we're very happy to co-support a research funding opportunity for music and the brain and health. We have some other activities, and you, of course, know about Sound Health. Just as the Arts Endowment gives grants to support arts projects and activities nationwide, so do we also award research grants to nonprofit organizations, school districts, colleges, and universities. We also run a program called NEA Research Labs, which I'll describe shortly. Just now I said we work with other federal agencies to pursue our research mission. For example, working with the U.S. Census Bureau and the Bureau of Economic Analysis, we use large data sets to understand how Americans engage with the arts overall, and what is, for example, the economic value of arts industries. This bar chart shows data from a survey we routinely conduct with the Census Bureau on how many Americans participate in the arts each year. By the most recent survey estimates in 2017, we find that 71% of all adults in the past year had used electronic or digital media to consume music on their cell phones, tablets, laptops, or more traditional media platforms. That's about 175 million adults. Meanwhile, 42% of adults reported having attended at least one live music performance in the last year. That need not have been a professional performance. Could have been singing in a choir, could have been other activities. And 30%, or 74 million Americans, had themselves performed or created music of some type. This chart corroborates what we already know, the near ubiquity of music listening and music making in our society. And Renée really said it, in a sense, much better, referring back even to evolutionary patterns. Apart from working with the Census Bureau to tally these kinds of statistics, we also convene regularly, about once a quarter, with researchers and program leaders across various government agencies and departments to look at issues concerning the arts and human development. Leading an interagency task force, we aim to catalyze new research and information sharing about the arts, health, and educational benefits across the lifespan. Currently, we have task force membership from 18 federal entities, including several NIH institutes. And this is relevant because it kind of gets to this partnership that we're doing very specific to music now. Here are the covers of some research publications we've produced, many but not all with the help of our task force partners. There's the Arts and Aging, which resulted from a meeting convened by NIH and the NEA at the National Academies of Sciences, a report titled How Creativity Works in the Brain, which grew from a collaboration with the Santa Fe Institute. Charles Lin, we saw just now, was part of that. The Arts in Early Childhood, the Arts and Achievement in At-Risk Youth, and a report based on arts data from the National Health and Retirement Study. We also have published a guide to collaboration between researchers and community arts groups and music groups in studying the arts relationship to health outcomes. All of these and many more are available at arts.gov. Now, with Dr. Collins and NIH watching from the wings, as it were, I hesitate more than usual to make any generalizations from the science thus far. Yet I'm emboldened to do so because of the sheer volume of studies that have borne out a largely positive relationship between arts participation and distinct classes of benefit for various age groups. Among young children, for example, we find that arts participation has been closely linked to improved emotional regulation, coping behavior, pro-social skills, perspective taking, and factors related to school readiness, such as language skills and vocabulary acquisition. Notably, these benefits seem to accrue for children from disadvantaged backgrounds. Among teenagers and young adults, we see gains in academic, social, and civic engagement among youth of lower socioeconomic status who have had a high exposure to arts activities relative to youth of the same backgrounds who have not had that level of arts exposure. And we see that older adults who engage in the arts either as creators or performers or as attendees at arts events tend to show slower rates of cognitive and physical decline than do other older adults as measured by their health profiles through longitudinal survey data. In many cases, music is an active ingredient in the arts program or arts behavior that's being studied. So let's turn to music and see what kinds of research we've been supporting. I told you that we offer research grants. Here's a quick sample to give you a flavor of projects using the social and behavioral sciences predominantly to investigate music and its impact. We're currently funding a research team working at Carnegie Hall on a quasi-experimental study that will examine factors predicting persistence in the study of classical music and perhaps in other domains. This will involve studying a national orchestra that recruits underserved and underrepresented youth. Previously, we funded Carnegie Hall's study of a choral music-based intervention being implemented in juvenile detention centers in New York City. At Colorado State University, we're supporting a series of studies examining the cognitive, physiological, and social benefits of live performing arts attendance, including music, for older adults with cognitive impairment and their caregivers. Meanwhile, the National Association for Music Educators, a nonprofit, is using longitudinal data from the U.S. Department of Education to understand how students who participated in music education in high school fared in comparison to their non-music peers in high school education, in high school engagement and college admissions, enrollment, and graduation. University of Florida has just wrapped up a study of what's called live preferential music involving professional musicians in hospital emergency care settings. Finally, University of Southern California is conducting a neuroscientific investigation of how music education, specifically an El Sistema-inspired music program, can benefit executive function and emotional regulation in teenagers from underprivileged communities in LA. In addition to research grants, we fund transdisciplinary research teams across the country to investigate the arts' value and impact using a variety of different research approaches and methodologies. These are the NEA research labs I spoke of earlier. Again, I'm just showing you a sample because as it happens, at least five of our research labs have a music focus. Drexel University is studying, among other things, the use of music therapy as a non-pharmacological option for dealing with post-operative pain from surgery. This is highly relevant to today's opioid crisis. UCSD is working in partnership with San Diego Children's Choir and the Vista Unified School District to study the potential effects of various musical interventions on early childhood development. A little to the north, UCSF under Charles Lin is using brain mapping to identify the neural substrates of creativity. Jazz improvisers are central to his experiments. Rice University has just been awarded a research lab to work with a contemporary music ensemble to measure the effects of sustained music engagement for older adults with mild cognitive impairments. Last but not least, Vanderbilt University Medical Center is working with Nashville Symphony Orchestra and others to assess the social and emotional effects of music on autistic children and their families. The lab will also conduct a national survey of music engagement by families with and without autistic children. I'm almost done, but I want to say a few words about a partnership we lead with the Departments of Defense and Veterans Affairs. It's called Creative Forces, the NEA Military Healing Arts Network, and it's led by Bill O'Brien at our agency. Creative Forces serves the special needs of military patients and veterans with traumatic brain injury and psychological health conditions and the needs of their families and caregivers. The program places creative arts therapies and certainly music therapy at the core of patient-centered care at 11 clinical sites, plus a telehealth program throughout the country. It increases access to community arts activities to promote health, wellness, and quality of life for these special populations. The program started with Walter Reed National Military Medical Center just outside DC, but on this slide, you can see all 11 sites. We've embarked on a clinical research agenda to evaluate some of the potential benefits of creative arts therapies for these populations, again, including music therapy, and already have sponsored some published studies. Finally, since today's presentations have been about the Sound Health Partnership, I want to call out another exciting opportunity that came to light as a result of our early meetings with NIH, the Kennedy Center, and Renée Fleming. We currently co-sponsor a National Institute on Drug Abuse study at NIH called ABCD, Adolescent Brain Cognitive Development. ABCD is a longitudinal study that aims to track 10,000 kids ages 9 and 10 all the way through early adulthood. The study uses a variety of different assessments and measurement techniques to study brain development and child health. Well, coming out of the early meetings regarding Sound Health, we decided to work with researchers to see if we can't nest questions in the ongoing data collection, surveys, et cetera, so that we can use this opportunity to learn more about how children engage with music in the arts, and ultimately can analyze the benefits of doing so. I have to credit Renée for the original idea of nesting music-related questions in large ongoing studies. This collaboration with ABCD seems a supreme example of this research strategy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sunil, and now we will go back to Renée Fleming for some closing comments.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Sunil. So our previous Surgeon General, Vivek Murthy, talked about the most dangerous epidemic we face being one of loneliness and isolation. It's a greater health hazard than obesity. And Dr. Collins and the NIH are working so hard to stem opioid addiction. Emotional and physical pain abound. But the U.S. has over 100,000 performing arts organizations. Most of them have moved beyond providing art and entertainment and have expanded into education and community service. So I believe we can collaborate with healthcare providers to improve the quality of life in our communities and, most importantly, create community. If warehouse stores and drug stores will provide kiosk and automated healthcare in the future, can't we also offer musical therapy, music lessons, choir, dance and drama, visual arts participation through our existing performing arts centers, backed by the science that proves the benefits for us and our families? What will the quality of life be for those whose jobs disappeared due to automation? It's not too soon to discuss this and what part our institutions can play. And finally, we're a divided country politically in the throes of a mass disconnect. Music binds us to each other and to our children. And I'm going to leave you with my very favorite example of bonding to music.
Daddy's going to play them a little song while they're eating their peas.
You guys ready?
Speakers, Renée Fleming, Sunil Iyengar, Dr. Frances Collins, and Deborah Rutter for this fantastic discussion of the Sound Health Project and insights into the effect that music can have on our brains and on our individual lives. The question and answer chat box is now open, so please feel free, any participants that are online, submit questions and we will relay them to the speakers. So a question for Dr. Collins. In recent studies, there has been a demonstration of music increasing levels of BDNF. Can you provide your thoughts on this? And perhaps for the non-scientists listening in, explain what BDNF is?
So BDNF is brain-derived neurotrophic factor, one of those peptides that gets generated by various parts of the brain in response to various activities. I have to confess, I'm not on top of that publication that suggests that the music can result in a release of this factor. I'm sitting next to Tom Cheever, who's my co-chair of the NIH working group. Tom, you got any insight on this one?
Same as you.
Okay, we need to Google that one. But yeah, it's probably an example of a lot of the things that are now possible with the kinds of technologies that we have to be able to see what's happening in real time. And of course, the brain initiative that I started out talking about is going to make even more of that happen. So BDNF today, who knows what it'll be tomorrow.
Thank you so much. We have another question from someone listening in asking, how can we improve access to music therapy to anybody who would benefit from it? I think it's a question that speaks to sort of the science behind it as well as our healthcare system. So that's open to anybody who would like to address it.
I just met with the head of the AMTA. This is Renée. And it's not universally covered by insurance. So a lot of hospitals in a lot of states, it's actually philanthropically funded. But there are still many organizations. The best thing to do is to go to the AMTA website and see what is in sort of a local area that can be found. And of course, increasing it the NIH is committed to actually shoring up the science. And maybe Dr. Collins can talk a little bit about that, that actually makes it less of a soft science and more of a hard science.
Exactly, because what third-party payers are looking for, and that includes CMS that funds Medicare and Medicaid, is evidence that this kind of intervention improves outcomes. And there are fantastic stories out there that you can read about or learn about in terms of what music therapy has done for individuals with strokes or traumatic brain injury or autism or Alzheimer's disease, a long list of conditions. And yet the third-party payers look at that and go, well, that's an anecdote. What they really want to see is rigorous controlled trials that will demonstrate the intervention does in fact improve outcomes, and then they'll feel like that's something that they should reimburse for. One of our goals is therefore to build up this evidence base for music therapy, which we have great admiration for, and give it that kind of rigor that will convince the insurance companies and the government insurance company called Medicare that this is something that should be reimbursed for, because music therapists otherwise are doing great work, but not always recognized for it in terms of the way in which their work gets recognized and reimbursed.
I think it's also helpful to point out the difference between music therapy and music medicine. Music medicine, generally speaking, is when performers go into a hospital, orchestras, et cetera, to perform and create that sort of artistic environment that brings ratings up, and Prescani ratings actually in hospitals go way up. Mm-hmm. But music therapy, these are therapists who are really trained in outcomes and in interventions and procedures that really improve health.
Good point.
We have a question that I think is for Deborah. How can cultural organizations like the Kennedy Center engage with the science and health community to increase access to music and health?
Thanks a lot, Paul. Great question. And I will tell you that it has been something that we think about here a lot, in that we are performing arts organizations. We don't know how best to speak about this topic with authority about the science. And that has been the value of working so closely with the NIH, and frankly, impressive and a great learning experience for us. I do believe that any performing arts organization, and in this case, music organizations, can and will find local individuals and scientists doing research and have findings. So it is about taking the risk of doing something that you're not familiar with, but to create these programs that actually start telling this story. And it is really, really positively received. And in both cases, our tickets went very quickly, very enthusiastically, because it's a topic people have a sense and an interest in. I would also say that While we have focused a lot on music because of the science that's supporting it, there is a fair bit of enthusiasm about exploring other parts of the arts and the visual arts and music therapy. And locally, you will find music therapists. We have gone beyond just these two sort of big public sets of events to working closely with smaller agencies in our region, community music school, music therapists, and institutions that are really interested in arts and the aging, to be able to bring to it what we do, which is performances, to help tell the story. So it's just a little creativity and actually finding great partners. But I think Renée can demonstrate that no matter what town you go to in America, there are places that want to explore this topic.
We have a question that sort of follows up on something you just said, Deborah. Could all of you maybe discuss a bit more the connections between music and aging and the brain and what we know?
Charles Lim, Dr.
No, go ahead,
Lim
Renée.
Actually does a lot of research on creativity and particularly improvisation, which has been shown to, I think, have the greatest increase in brain activity. And there's no question that with all of the research now that supports this idea of staying active and learning, you know, lifelong learning, music is a great way to do that. I'm sorry, go ahead, Dr. Collins.
Well, I think Charles has highlighted that quite nicely. I do think in a specific instance, which is music and its effort to try to reach people who are suffering from Alzheimer's disease, there are really remarkably touching experiences where individuals who seem really quite disconnected from what's happening around them, quite withdrawn, then brought into a circumstance of a familiar tune, are suddenly alive again. They're enthusiastically lit up with sparkle in their eye and maybe a clap in their hand to follow a piece of music that somehow taps into a part of the brain that had otherwise not been able to be touched. Similarly, people, I had the experience of listening to one of the last concerts that Glenn Campbell ever gave when he was clearly suffering quite severely from the ravages of Alzheimer's disease, and watching him on stage with his family band playing guitar with remarkable skill. I mean, not missing a lick and some very fancy kinds of arpeggios. And then going backstage to talk to him where he was clearly completely lost about what was going on and who was around him. Dramatic difference. There's something about those circuits that connect to music that are somehow spared, or at least somewhat spared. And the more that we can tap into that for individuals who are suffering from cognitive decline, the more you preserve their opportunity to be participatory in what's going on and give them joy.
I would just, this is Sunil, I would just say that also one of the speakers who was at the one of the Sound Health convenings, or maybe I think both of them, Nina Kraus from Northwestern University, had shown how people who had kept with music over a period of years, practicing it regularly, somehow were able to stave off, it seems, attentional deficits, and we're able to preserve auditory memory much better, and it seemed to transfer to longer term retention, but particularly around listening and discerning even speech when you get older, and that also translated to some potential benefits in terms of overall memory. So that was a particularly neat finding. May not have been to treat acutely, you know, an acute condition, but it was something that seemed like the general population could benefit from.
There was a study last year also in the UK that said that singing in a choir shores up your immune system. So there you have it.
We have another question that builds off something that Dr. Collins just mentioned relating to the familiarity of music. How can we work to be inclusive as we develop music therapies? For instance, some cultures have melodically complex music and different cultures value different rhythmic styles. The person asking the question can imagine a Mexican-American Alzheimer's patient experiencing different outcomes depending on whether they are treated with culturally relevant music therapies.
Yeah. It's a great question, and Renée may want to weigh in on this too. I think an experienced music therapist totally recognizes the importance of understanding the cultural context and before engaging with a patient that they're trying to help in some way, understand sort of what their experience with music has been, what kind of music they might be most likely to be touched by. And of course, that's not just because of which country you grew up in, it's also which part of the culture you're familiar with. If somebody tried to get me to feel better, they'd probably want to try Beethoven before they would try rap, but that's just how I'm wired. So we have to have that conversation before we started the therapeutic episode.
Well, and traditionally music therapy has really used the guitar and the piano as the underlying instruments, and of course voice singing as well. But that might expand to include a broader variety of music through all of the technology that we have now that can disseminate music quickly and in any key. So that's one thing I think they may be looking at. And also, as you said, Dr. Collins, it's not just your culture, it's your age, it's your experience, your life experience. So music therapists have a large body of repertoire at their fingertips, but it will have to continually expand. And one last thing, I just met some MIT researchers who are looking at harmonicity. That was a word I didn't know, but it has to do with the microtonality and all of the different cultural world music that is far different from any kind of Western music that we know, whether classical or pop, and trying to see, and they're discovering that it really is, the power of music is specific to communities and cultures. So it's a lot to learn.
And the 12-tone scale is limiting?
Yes, that's right.
So we have one final question, and I think it's for all four of you. Can you discuss what some of the future trends and directions in research in this field will be? Where is it going?
Could I throw out an aspirational trend? It may not actually happen, but I certainly would like to see it happen. I think as sort of shown in the microcosm here with all of us partners, I think we're going to need much more transdisciplinary work or cross-disciplinary work to do this right from different segments of research, but also different practices. So, you know, we just talked about different cultures. I certainly think that, what was great about this, as Dr. Collins has said, is, you know, you're bringing together music therapy with neuroscience, with musicians, with educators. And I think to have that dialogue and strengthen it is going to make the results manifold and much better. So that's, I guess it's the hope. I don't know if it's a trend.
Yeah, this is Francis. I think I would agree. And I think, again, because we are investing a lot now in developing these technologies that allow a much more precise assessment of what's happening in real time in circuits in the brain, we should be able to grant to music therapy interventions a much better sense of what's working and why it works when it works, and therefore to build upon that. I mean, imagine that you have somebody who suffered a traumatic brain injury. The music therapist is trying to help them with the development of an ability to speak, perhaps by singing before you speak, because that seems to be a pathway that actually works quite remarkably for some individuals. But you're not only just watching that session in terms of what happens between the therapist and the patient, you also have real-time imaging of which circuits in the brain are being affected, and you can kind of get a sense, ooh, that one's pretty close to where we need to be. Let's try something a little different in that regard. That the ability to have real-time feedback of what's happening with the details of the brain's neural circuits at the time where you're trying to optimize therapy. That's going to be a very exciting future frontier. And I don't think we're too far away from that if you'll give us 4 or 5 years.
This is Deborah, and I would like to add to the aspirational aspect of what's coming. What I have experienced, and I've shared a little bit in the conversation here, is the really enthusiastic interest from families, educators, policymakers, and colleagues. So I really have an aspiration that the story around the importance of music every day in our lives in one form or another and participation in it, which of course leads you to say we need music education in schools and that we need to embed music in the lives so that as we age, as we look to modes of healing, but that there's a broader awareness of this. And I say this because I really, every place that we've gone, every place that Renée has been able to make this presentation, there's been a really enthusiastic reaction from not always obvious bedfellows. So we're very close to, for instance, here in DC, we're very close to the Levine Music School. I had no idea that they had a really major music therapy program. They've come to us and say, you know, our music therapy program needs to be richer from a content perspective. Can we partner with you to train musicians to partner with our music therapists? We don't expect them to become music therapists, but to understand the role of music therapy. It cross-trains musicians for another aspect of their professional lives, as well as enhancing the programs, as Renée mentioned so often, you know, guitar or percussion with a music therapist. So I really think that the more we can tell this story about the power and the value of this, the more we can really form an army across the country of people who are interested in advocating for this more positively in our lives.
This is Paul Erickson from the American Academy. On behalf of the Commission on the Arts and everyone here at the Academy, I would like to thank our speakers today, Renée Fleming, Francis Collins, Deborah Rutter, and Sunil Iyengar, for this fascinating discussion of the connections between neuroscience and music. I would like to remind everybody participating that videos of many of the Sound Health Project's events are available on the Kennedy Center's YouTube page. A recorded version of today's webinar will be available on the Academy's website. And finally, I would like to thank Mark Robinson and Lonson Michelle here at the Academy for crucial technical support, which made this possible. And please stay tuned for future webinars from the Commission on the Arts. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.